This is lesson 2.4. In this lesson, we're going to be learning about equations that have special solutions, such as no solution or infinitely many solutions. Our primary focus then is being able to solve equations that have no solution and being able to recognize that. The same thing with infinitely many solutions, which in some situations may be all real numbers. And then also being able to justify and explain those special cases. We'll also look at some word problems where those end up being the answers, that any number would work for the variable, or that there would be no number that works for the variable. This continues our study of equations and how they're used to solve and model real-life situations and answer questions about them. In particular, today we're talking about what does it mean to have no solution and what does it mean to have infinitely many solutions. We're going to be using all of the same equation solving skills that we have over this unit so far. We'll clear out fractions if necessary, we'll distribute, combine like terms, and use opposite operations in order to get the variables by itself. So let's look at this example. So we have quite a bit going on here. We've got variables on both sides, and we have some like terms that we need to combine. So we should always try to combine like terms first. So when we look on the left side, there isn't anything to combine together. I've got 3x and I've got 15. So my next step is just going to have 3x plus 15. Nothing to do there. On the right side, though, we do have some like terms that we can combine. I can combine my x's together, and I can combine my constants together. So we've got 2x plus an x, and remember that is a 1x. So that gives me 3x. And then I've got 10 plus 5. Well, 10 plus 5 is 15. So we've combined like terms, and then you can see what we have now on both sides. And then normally we would try to get the variable by itself, and we have variables on both sides, so we'll use opposite operations to get the variables to be on the same side. So we have 3x on the right side, and that's a positive 3x, so we'll subtract 3x from both sides in order to get the variables to be on the same side. So we have 3x minus 3x. Well, 3x minus 3x is 0, so I'm left with 15 on the right side. And then on the left side, I have 3x minus 3x again. Well, we just saw on the right side that that's 0. So that's interesting. My x's are gone on both sides of my equation. And now I have 15 equals 15. So what does that mean? So in this situation here, we ended up with a statement that is true. Do you agree that 15 equals 15? So when the variable disappears and you're left with a true statement, then that means that the solution is all real numbers, or the textbook calls it infinitely many solutions. What that means is that I can substitute any number into that equation, and the left and the right side will be the same. I could substitute in a negative number, a positive number, a square root. I could substitute pi in, even though you might not be comfortable dealing with pi as a number and not approximating it as 3.14. Doesn't matter what number I substitute in, the left and the right side will be the same. Now, there's actually, you could have known that back here in this step. If you look at the left side and the right side, they are the same. 3x plus 15 will always equal 3x plus 15, no matter what you substitute in for x. Because on the left side, you're going to do 3 times whatever x is, and then add 15. And you do the exact same thing on the right side, 3 times x plus 15. So no matter what number you substitute in for x, the left and the right side will be equal, which by definition is the definition of a solution for an equation. So again, to summarize, when you're solving an equation and you end up with a true statement where the variables have disappeared, so the variables are gone, they add it to zero, then that means that the solution is all real numbers or infinitely many solutions. If you recognize ahead of time, like back here, that the answer is going to be all real numbers, then you're more than welcome to stop there and state the answer. You don't have to continue working it out until you get like 15 equals 15 or something like that. So here's another example. Let's see what happens with this one. So on the left side, I don't have anything to do, so I have 3x plus 15. I do have like terms, so I have a 10 and a 4, so that's going to give me 14. And then for my x's, I have 2x and I have 1x, which that gives me 3x. Then we'll go ahead and we'll subtract 3x from both sides so that we can get the x's together. Well, just like in the last problem, I have 3x minus 3x, that's 0. And on the left side, I have 3x minus 3x, which is 0. So I end up with 15 equals 14. Now, hopefully you're scratching your head a little bit for this, because does 15 equal 14? No, that's false. And so, unlike the last problem, where we ended up with a statement that was true and would always be true, 15 will always equal 15, here we have a situation where the statement is false. 14 does not equal 15. And so, because the statement is false and the variables have disappeared, then that means that this solution is no solution. There is no number that you can substitute into the equation that will make the left side and the right side be equal. So again, when the variables cancel, and you're left with a false statement, then the solution is no solution. As with the previous one, we could have stopped here, because 3x plus 15 will never equal 3x plus 14, because the 3x's, they'll always be the same amount, regardless of whatever you substitute in for x. And then on the left side, you're adding 15, and the right side, you're only adding 14. So those won't be the same on the left and the right side, that sum. So you can stop here earlier if you recognize that the answer is going to be no solution. So here's what it means to be no solution and infinitely many solutions or all real numbers. So for no solution, it means that there is no real number. So no irrational number, no rational number, no integer, no fraction, no decimal that you deal with. There are no real number that can be substituted into the equation that will make the two sides of the equation be true, that will make the equation be equal. And so that's what it means to be no solution. And for infinitely many solutions, it means that any number that you substitute into the equation will make it be true. You do want to know those two definitions, because those will be part of our explanations when we have problems like that that we need to explain. This problem is for you to do, so go ahead and pause the video, solve the equation, and write the solution, and then resume the video to see the answer. So you should have ended up at the end having your variables add to zero and disappear, and ending up with a false statement of 8 equals 3, or something similar depending on how you solved it. The one thing to keep in mind is if you chose to solve this in a different way by adding or subtracting different things, the important part is that the variables disappear and that your statement is either true or false. And in this case, the statement that's left is false. So whether it was 8 equals 3, or 0 equals negative 5, or whatever it may end up being, whatever you have on your paper, the important part is it's false, it's not true. And so because the variables have disappeared, your statement is false, then the answer is no solution. There isn't any number that I can substitute in for the x in these three spots that will allow the left side and the right side of the equation to be the same. You are more than welcome to have stopped here in that second step, because 4x plus 8 will never equal 4x plus 3. You're adding different amounts to the same value, 4x, on both sides. So they'll never be equal. So let's look at some application problems. So here we have a rectangle and a triangle, and they ask us to determine for what values of x will the rectangle and the triangle have the same perimeter. So the first thing you need to understand is, what is perimeter? Do you remember what perimeter means? Perimeter is the total distance around a shape, a two-dimensional shape. And so when we're finding perimeter, so if we have the perimeter of the rectangle, then we need to add up the four sides. So we have the length, then we have the second length, then we have the width, and the width. And I'm okay if you would do that in your head. You don't have to write out the big long sum like that. You can look over here and say, okay, 2x plus 2x is 4x, plus one more is 5, plus another one is 6. So then that gives me 6x. And then I add up my 3 and my 3 to give me plus 6. I'm okay if you do that in your head. For the triangle, I'm going to simply just do it in my head. So I'm going to add up the three sides. And when I do that, I add up 2x plus 2x plus 2x. So that gives me 6x. And then when I add up 2 plus 2 plus 2 for the constants, that gives me 6. So I have my two perimeters, and I want to know when the perimeter of the rectangle equals the perimeter of the triangle. That's what this is asking me for. What values of x will make those be equal? So let's substitute in our perimeters. So the rectangle one is 6x plus 6. The triangle one is 6x plus 6. And if you look, you could stop right here, and you can see that these are the same on both sides. So that means they'll always be true. If I substitute in 0 for x, which isn't realistic for a rectangle, then you get 6 equals 6, and that is true. So we'll talk more about what x is allowed to be here in a second. So this equation, if we would solve it, we could subtract 6x from both sides in order to get the x's together. Well, the x's don't, not only do they get together, but they also add to 0. 6x minus 6x is 0. 6x minus 6x is 0, and we get 6 equals 6, which is a true statement, which again is telling me that there are infinite solutions. Now here's where there's a difference between application and equation. The equation tells me that every number works. So I could substitute in a positives and negatives and roots and pies and all sorts of weird things, and it would be a solution. But then we have to talk about the context of the problem. So when we actually go to answer the final part of the problem, as far as what values of x will work, we have to think about what it means to be a perimeter and what it means to be a distance. So while I agree that this equation right here has infinitely many solutions, what values for x are acceptable? Well, can you have a negative length on a rectangle or a triangle? No. So x can't be anything that would give you a negative for the length or the side lengths of these two shapes. So all the negative numbers are out. And 0 doesn't make sense either, because how do you have a length or width of 0? So that's sort of gibberish. But it could be numbers that are greater than that. So in this situation, the x can be any number greater than 0. So it could be tiny decimals. We could have a really tiny, 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 skinny rectangle. That's okay, because then it would still end up having the same perimeter as the triangle when I substitute in 0.001 for the two shapes. There are still infinitely many solutions, but we're a little bit restricted based on the application, because for a distance, distances have to be positive. So here's another problem. So we have Gil makes 3 bracelets and Micah makes 2 bracelets. They both use the same number of string colors, and we have some information here over in a picture. How many colors should they use to make the same amount of money? Okay, so the best thing to do is to start to piece together the pieces of information, and we want to know when they have the same amount of money, so we have to calculate Gil's total money and Micah's total money. So what do we know about Gil? Well, we know that Gil is making three bracelets. And we have that other information over in the problem that we have it's $5 per bracelet. And I'm going to abbreviate. And then we've got $2 per color string that we use. Micah's is similar. Micah is charging $3 per bracelet. And $3 for each color string that she uses. And Micah is only making two bracelets, though. My variable is how many colors. I don't know how many colors are used. In this situation, it might be a little bit easier to construct each of their totals separately and then make our equations off to the side. So for Gil's total, well, let's see. You're going to pay for the bracelets. You have $5 per bracelet times the number of bracelets. So it's going to cost $15 for the bracelets at a base minimum. Then we get charged more based off of the colors. Well, two colors per string times x strings. So that's going to be 2x. If there were three strings, that would be $6. If there was one string, that would be an additional $2. So Gil's total equation calculation is 15 plus 2x. For Micah, we'll have something similar, but the numbers will be a little bit different. You have two bracelets at $3 a piece, so that's going to be $6 for the bracelets at a base price. And then we've got $3 per string, so we got three times the number of strings, similar to Gil's. So I want to know when these two are the same. So I want to know when does 15 plus 2x equal 6 plus 3x. So we'll need to solve. So we'll start by getting my x's to be on the same side. So we'll subtract 2x from both sides. Again, the opposite of addition is subtraction. We're left with 15 on the left side and 6 plus x on the right side. Then we will subtract 6 from both sides. And we get x equals 9. And 9 represents the number of strings used. So I'll go ahead and write my answer. So if they use 9 colors of string, then the cost of the bracelets will be the same. And I'm going to add string here. Now, the one thing you might be curious about is, well, that's not a special case. That's a normal problem that you can solve, and we got a single answer. And yes, that's actually part of the lesson too, is being able to recognize when is it going to have one solution. Or when is it going to have no solution or infinitely many solutions? And so if you look back at my equation, notice what happens here that doesn't happen in the other two equations we looked at on the previous couple slides, which is the variables don't cancel out. My rates that are being multiplied by the variable, my coefficients, if we want to speak more generically, are not the same. And so when I go to subtract, I'm still left with some x values, in this case, 1x left over, and I can solve for that variable. So when we go to look at these, that's what we're going to look for. Does the variable, will it cancel out, or do I have the same variable on both sides, like a 3x and a 3x, or a 5x and a 5x? Or do I have this situation where they're different, and then that would be one solution? So in our next example here, these three, we are going to try to determine how many solutions there are without having to solve the equations. So you're going to do what I just said, is we're going to look at it and we're going to see that, okay, if I look at the left and the right side, my x's do not have the same coefficients. So that means when I subtract the 1 over, I'm going to have x's left over. I'm going to have x on one side that I can then solve for. So that means that this has to be one solution. Now I'm going to write something out here, and then it will pop back up. So here's my explanation. I sort of already said it verbally, but then you should put it in writing because it asks you to explain. So again, since the x terms are not the same, we have 3x and we have 2.5x on opposite sides. When we go to combine them together by using opposite operations, they won't cancel, which will then allow you to solve the equation for x and get not x solutions, but get one solution. So that would be your answer and explanation for A. Now, you may have to do a little bit of fiddling mentally when you look at these. It just says you don't need to solve them in the directions. So if I look at this, if I would distribute, I see that I have 3x on both sides. So I know that when I go to subtract those over, they'll cancel out. So I'm definitely looking at a special case here. Then I need to look at the constants. Are the constants the same or are they different? If the constants are the same, then that's going to be infinitely many solutions. If they're different, then it's no solution. Well, if I look on the left side, I have 6, and on the right side, I have negative 6. Well, those are not the same. So 3x plus 6 will never equal 3x minus 6, because you're taking the same value, 3x, on both sides, whatever you substitute in for x. And on the one side, you're adding 6, and on the other side, you're subtracting. And those are not going to be equal then, because you're moving in different directions on the number line. One's going to the right for the plus 6, and one's going to the left for the minus 6, but starting from the same number. So this one is going to be no solution. And I'll go ahead and write an explanation here. Now the explanation is a little bit shorter because it's a little more straightforward, where you have two things that can never be equal. Those can't be equal, as we already discussed. So the last one here, again, we can do a little bit of mental math in our head, a little manipulation to look at it. So I've got a 9x minus 4 here. On the other side, I do have some like terms, and so that would give me 9x, and then also a minus 4. So those match. So those are identical. So the left side and the right side will always be equal because they're the same thing. And so that is an example of your infinitely many solutions or all real numbers, depending on what the expectation is from your teacher and textbook. Me personally, I feel that the answer should be all real numbers in this context for these types of equations. But the textbook that we use calls it infinitely many solutions. So there are infinite solutions. And our explanation is going to be pretty similar to the last one, that 9x minus 4 will always equal 9x minus 4. I mean, they're the same. So let's look at another example. So we have the height of an experimental plant after x days can be represented by the formula 3 times the quantity 4x plus 2. The height of a second plant can be represented by the formula 6 times the quantity 2x plus 2. Is it possible for the two plants to ever be the same height? So we want to know, will these ever be equal? So let's set them equal to each other and solve it and see what we get. Will we get one answer? Will we get infinite answers, or will we get no solution? Let's find out. So we'll need to distribute. So we got 3 times 4, which is 12x, and we get 3 times 2, which gives me 6. On the other side, we get 6 times 2, which is 12, so we get 12x, and then we have 6 times 2, which equals 12. Now, I can see right here what the solution is, but let's just take it one step further. So you can subtract 12x from both sides to get the x's together. Well, 12x minus 12x is 0. 12x minus 12x is 0. And then you get 6 equals 12. Well, does 6 equal 12? No, it doesn't. It's false. So that means that this equation has no solution. And so now I can answer the question. So since the equation is not true, since the left side does not equal the right side for any x value, that's what it means to be no solution, then the two plants will never be the same height. Now, I guess you could say in reality, when the plants are dead and decomposed, they'll eventually be the same height, zero. But if we're talking about a living plant that's growing and not overanalyzing the situation, like students do sometimes, then we're looking at there is no solution. There is no amount of time that can pass where those two plants will be the same height. This problem is for you to do. So go ahead and start to set up the equation. And before you solve it, resume the video to see if you have the right equation. Then you can pause the video again to solve it and see the final answer. So here's our equation. Now, I didn't write out and label a bunch of the information because it's already organized in the image that we are given. So the yogurt is a fixed value and the honey is a fixed value. You're buying a jar of each of those. And the real thing that varies is based on how much is the fruit going to cost you. And they tell us that they buy the same number of pieces of fruit. It's a little awkward, perhaps, in this situation because we're talking about two different types of fruit. But my variable is we're buying the same number of fruit. So whether it's peaches or apples, they're buying five of them or six of them or seven of them. So x here, my variable definition, is the number of pieces of fruit that they purchase. And then individually. And that value is going to be the same for both. And then we have rates, which is how much the peaches cost. And we have a rate of how much the apples cost. And so if you look at my two equations, hopefully you're becoming familiar with the setups by now after several lessons on word problems, that we have our fixed value being added to the amount that we're paying for the fruit. And we do the rate times the amount of fruit that we purchase in order to get that money amount. And the same thing is true on Agnes's side. So we have 6 plus 1x. You don't need the 1 here in your equation, but I wanted to put it there to be consistent so that you're seeing that it's the rate times the amount. But if you want to leave it off, say in the next step, you're more than welcome to do that. So now that you have the equation, go ahead and pause the video, solve the equation, and answer the question, and then resume the video to see the answer. So here is the answer. You should have ended up with x equals 8, and you can see the work for solving the equation there. So we didn't end up with no solution. It is possible for them to end up with the same total cost. And we didn't end up with any answer being the correct answer. We didn't end up with infinitely many solutions. I did check it to see what that value would be. So over here, what you're seeing is I substituted in 8 into the x spot for the two expressions. So 8 times $1.25 for the peaches plus 14 gave me $14. And then 8 times 1 plus 6 for Agnes's total bill also gives you $14. And you can see then that for 8 pieces of fruit, we ended up with the same total for each person. And then you can see I wrote that there down here in my description. So in this lesson, we learned about two of the special cases for equations. We learned when an equation can have no solution, and we learned when an equation could have infinitely many solutions. And what that means is, for no solution, it means that there isn't any number that you can substitute into the equation in which the left and the right side will be equal. And for infinite many solutions, that means that any number you substitute into your equation, the left side and the right side of the equation will be true. So in your homework, we'll be looking at problems where you're recognizing whether it is no solution or all real numbers or infinitely many solutions. And we'll also be doing problems like this where you still work them out and you end up with one answer. This concludes the lesson. You are now ready to begin the homework.